Much appreciated that you still made it. So, it is my honor today to introduce our last plenary speaker of the 7th IMCC. Angelo Villagomez, recently named one of the 500 most influential people in Washington, D.C. by the Washingtonian magazine, has dedicated his career to ocean advocacy, and his passion for the sea conveys a commitment towards indigenous-led conservation and ocean justice. He's a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress, where he's brought his unique perspective, blending indigenous knowledge with Western science to tackle some of the toughest environmental issues like habitat loss, overfishing, and climate colonialism. The Society for Conservation Biology also recognized Angelo in 2017 with a Distinguished Service Award for his role in establishing the Mariana Trench Marine National Monument in 2009, and the successful campaign to expand the Papahanao Mokuakea Marine National Monument in 2016, at the time the world's largest marine protected area. Angelo's proudest achievement came earlier this year when he was invited to introduce the U.S. Secretary of Interior, Deb Haaland, before she made the announcement of the completion of the Mariana Trench Monument Management Plan, a process that took more than 15 years. But beyond his impressive resume, Angelo is also a self-proclaimed mediocre ukulele player. I think you've heard him playing the ukulele at some point this week. Today, Angelo brings his dynamic expertise and enthusiasm to our states, and I'm sure he will inspire us all to take action for the oceans. I hope you are ready for it. Please join me in welcoming Angelo Villagomez.
That was the wrong song. Ironically, that was karma. And hopefully karma doesn't bite me in the ass for the things I'm about to say. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Beyond 30 by 30 era. This is my first time in South Africa. And I just want to thank our wonderful hosts for welcoming us all here and for treating us so well in your home. When Dr. Judy gave her plenary on like a month ago or 2 days ago, I'm not sure. She joked about always being the last person on the last day, and I was sitting right there in the audience thinking, "Hey, yeah, that's me." Looking forward to being here today. I just want to also thank the SCB Marine Section, the Conference Steering Committee, and the conference co-chairs for hosting an excellent conference this week. Can we give them a round of applause? And I want to thank all of you for getting up so early on the last day. I saw pictures of karaoke last night. Thanks for coming to hear me speak. My name is Angelo Villagomez, and I live in Washington, D.C., and I work for an organization called the Center for American Progress. My work these days is almost solely focused on the waters of the United States. So I want to recognize that there are people from 72 countries here this week, and that my experience may not be fully applicable or relatable to yours. Our organization makes recommendations to the United States government on how to improve the lives of Americans through bold progressive ideas, as well as strong leadership and concerted action. I direct our oceans work, and I lead our efforts to collaborate with indigenous peoples on conservation efforts in the US. The title of my talk today is 5 years to 30 by 30, thinking beyond 30 by 30. But what do I mean by beyond? We are very much in the 30 by 30 era. 30 by 30 isn't going away, and it shouldn't go away. At a macro level, 30 by 30 is a way to explain that parts of our ocean are sacred, and the other parts of our ocean should be used for shipping, for fishing, and all of the other human activities that we need. Should that number be 30%, 10%, 50%? And when are we done? I honestly think that's all up for vigorous academic debate. But 30 by 30 is easy to communicate. it might be easy to measure. Governments like it, and they've committed to it. Funders love it, and there are great examples of where it works. Like with the Micronesia Challenge, where I'm from, and then I learned about the network of MPAs in South Africa this week. Things seem to be working really well here. But this conversation, it needs to evolve beyond 30 by 30 into something new. For example, 30 by 30 does not capture the greater attention conservation is giving to human rights, equity, anti-racism, and indigenous rights that all of us heard so much about this week. Just as the conservation movement has evolved from prioritizing scenic landscapes 100 years ago, to wildlife, to biodiversity, now climate change, we need better language, frames of thinking, and zippy catchphrases to explain what it is that we're trying to do. And it's not that we should throw 30 by 30 out. I want to be clear about that. We should keep those inspiring parts, but we are in dire need of a better paradigm to help us understand our relationship to the ocean post-2031. Slide. There we go. I've been involved in efforts to protect 30% of the ocean and create marine protected areas for almost 20 years now. It's been quite a journey. Most of my remarks today are based on that experience, and I'm going to bounce around at different scales, and I'll try to be clear when I'm doing so. I've worked on the ground in Pacific Islands, advocating for individual protected areas, in Washington, D.C., on the federal side of things, and globally, as much as any individual person can actually do that. Earlier this year, the Biden administration announced that the United States had conserved, and use of that specific word is important here, about one-third of the U.S. ocean. This is part of the America the Beautiful initiative. It's the United States version of 30 by 30, and it attempts to tackle biodiversity loss, climate change, and our country's history of inequities through conservation efforts. But adding up how much of the ocean is actually protected or conserved in the United States very much depends on who you ask. This map here is made by my friends at the Marine Conservation Institute, and many scientists have adopted the MPA guide as our measuring stick, right? And we would prefer that the U.S. only claimed 26%. That is far lower than the 72% claimed by fisheries groups, and far, far lower than the 500% that I just saw a face over there be like, what, 500%? That's claimed by an industry group funded by oil companies. But if you look at the surface at these numbers, most of the MPAs in the U.S. are in the U.S. Pacific Islands. It's Hawaii, Guam, American Samoa, Northern Mariana Islands. And if you look at the smaller numbers on the slide over here, you'll see that virtually none of U.S. waters around the lower 48, Alaska, Caribbean, are strongly protected or marine reserves. Like, just imagine this was like your semester report card, and you took history of fashion, and you're doing really great in history of fashion, but you're failing all of everything else. That's what's going on in the United States right now. But specifically, 99.7% of the marine reserves in the U.S. are around the Pacific Islands. About a year ago, fully half of those waters lacked management plans. But for four years, the Biden administration has done a ton of work, and they've made great progress. Now we're down to only 40% are lacking management plans. And I'm here to confess that I played a role in this. I'm not rich or powerful enough to have been the conductor, but I was in the orchestra the whole time, playing my ukulele, mediocrely. At some point in my career, I helped designate or expand all of the big protected areas in the Pacific. But before I really get started, I just want to hammer home the point that this talk is not a call to disregard 30 by 30. 30 by 30 does have strengths. This is a call to go beyond 30 by 30, to learn from our mistakes from the last decade so that marine protected area designation and management in the 2030s is better than it is today. We need a more holistic and equitable approach to ocean management, wherein access, equity, and quality are measured alongside quantity and given equal consideration. So here's my island from the Pacific Ocean here. South Africa is over there. If you kind of zoom in over here, these are all together the Mariana Islands with the Mariana Trench living along here for the island of Saipan, kind of right there in the middle. This is two separate U.S. territories. Down here is just the U.S. territory of Guam, and these all together are the Northern Mariana Islands where Stephen and I are from. Next slide. Got some of the best beaches in the world. If you saw Stephen's presentation, we actually took the picture of the same exact beach in our slides. These are my grandparents on my dad's side. Now, I'm sure a wild fact about my family. My great-grandfather, Rafael, was born when we were a Spanish colony. My grandparents, seen here, were born when we were a German colony. And then many of my dad's older brothers and sisters were born when we were a Japanese colony. And then everybody since World War II, since 1945, has been born under the US flag. So if any of you folks out there think that colonialism is something that was left in the past, I'm standing right here. It's colonialism is still very much here. My parents, I'm mixed race, that's why I have lighter skin. I get my hair from my mom. But I get the shape of my body from my dad. Growing up on the island, spent a lot of time hunting, fishing with my cousins and other relatives. My parents didn't stay married, so I would spend part of the year with mom in the U.S., and then I'd get shipped out to the islands where this is where we kept all of our guns, so I had access to those. We had our fishing nets. Music was always a big part of our lives. But like all men of a certain age, I would always like take pictures of myself holding fish, you know, holding a fish, the crab this time. After college, I had a brief stint in Japan, then I moved home. I was a community organizer. I founded an environmental coalition and I organized weekly beach cleanups and tree plantings. And it was around this time that I was hired by the Pew Charitable Trust to run their campaign for a large protected area in the Mariana Islands. In this photo here, I'm standing in front of a map of our islands, and I'm holding up, I think it's a science report, and from the looks of it, I'm talking about deep sea vents. Now, Pew was involved in the 2006 designation of what is today the Papahanaumokuakea Marine National Monument. And after that success, they scoped the world for other places where that success could be repeated. I don't have a map here, but at the time, there were only three large marine protected areas. There was Great Barrier Reef in Australia, there was Hawaii, and then there was Phoenix Islands in Kiribati. My involvement in what eventually became the Mariana Trench Monument started in January 2007 when I met with Jay Nelson from Pew. We sat down for 2 hours, and he explained how Pew had funded a study, and they were trying to identify potential protected areas around the world modeled after what had happened in Hawaii. Now, over the years, I heard him give this pitch to many other people several times, so this is kind of like seared into my brain. But Pew was looking for places that were big, with limited amounts of fishing, and a country with a history of conservation and some hope of enforcement. And I'm gonna come back to these four criteria in my talk a little bit later, but for now, I'm just gonna say that the Marianas clearly ticked all of these boxes. Oh, there we go, sorry. I'm like clicking two things here. 24 months later, a few trips to DC, countless meetings, petitions, and letters in between, I was invited to the White House to watch President Bush, and he designated what were at the time three of the largest protected areas in the world, Rose Atoll, Pacific Remote Islands, and Mariana Trench. You'll hear a lot of conservation advocates call these designations a finish line. Hindsight assures me they are truly starting lines. But on that day, you can see I was just like a happy dude. I took my picture with Sylvia Earle and, you know, one of the Cousteaus, and President Bush kind of nodded at me as he talked about the work that they were doing with indigenous peoples. But I had no idea at the time that it was going to take 15 years to go from designation to management plan, or that nearly all of the funding was going to go to Hawaii or to support researchers in U.S. universities in the mainland. About a year later, I moved to D.C. I worked for Pew for another 12 years. I was a D.C. policy wonk, very much like a swamp creature. I worked on sharks for 5 years at Pew, and then I went back to protected areas. I worked for the Pew Bertarelli Ocean Legacy, and then helped found the Blue Nature Alliance. Now, the Bush monuments, they kicked off a global race to designate larger marine protected areas around the world. We've seen this slide a couple times this week. Between 2006 and today, there's been a 10 times increase in the amount of ocean that was protected. This growth wasn't accidental. For more than 20 years, scientists and governments have been calling for increased protections on the ocean. Starting with the Millennium Development Goals in 2000, here are some of these agreements mapped against the actual area of protected. Whether it was 8.4, 10%, 30%, outcomes on the water have always lagged far behind what our goals were. So we're at 30 by 30 right now. And I just want to share some of the language that these targets have in them, because it often gets shortened to 20 by 20 or 30 by 30, but there's actually so much more in these agreements. The Durban Agreement from 2003 mentions strict protections. My work on 30 by 30 started in 2006 with the start of the regional 30% goal in Micronesia. This is called the Micronesia Challenge, started by Pew Fellow Willie Koska and the president of Palau. In 2011, we introduced the term Other Effective Conservation Measures, or OECMs. The 2014 and 2016 IUCN agreements talk about highly protected and no extractive activities. We're also seeing language for indigenous peoples for the first time. You know, it took them quite a while to get there. But strict and highly protected is noticeably absent from the Kunming-Montreal targets. There's one happening in, like, tomorrow, but there's literal conferences where people talk about all this language. So I'm not going to dive too deep. I just kind of wanted to show some of the stuff there. Also, before I really get into it, this plenary is not a criticism of MPAs. Like, MPAs are great. We have the science to know when MPAs work and when they don't work. And we also have Daniel Pauly. This is one of his slides from Impact 5 last year. And he writes, "It is now quasi-impossible to assert with a straight face that MPAs do not work the way they are intended to." So I know all of you are just going to accept what Dr. Pauly said. But we know that MPAs work. My questions are rather, do area targets lead to more and better MPAs? So maybe you can help answer me. Maybe all of you in the audience can help me answer that. Were you expecting audience participation? All right. Anybody awake? Stand up if you're awake. Let's get that blood flowing. It's 8 in the morning. Stand up if you're awake. All right. If you think that 30 by 30 is informed by science, stand up. Everyone. Oh, everybody. Terrific. Is it measurable? Okay. Lots of people standing up. Is it equitable? Oh, no. Oh, no. Okay. Oh, peer pressure. Is it justice-oriented? Is it racist? Okay. All right, look around. Y'all are the ones who should talk to each other after this plenary. Oops, I go back. So I started off with a slide of the United States showing how nearly all of the marine reserves in the Pacific Islands are overseas territories. I also briefly touched on how, despite 99.7% of the marine reserves in the U.S. being in the islands, most of the people working and benefiting from marine reserves or in the United States are not Pacific Islanders. I drilled down a little bit on my personal experiences in the Marianas and how the unlikeliest of presidents sought to secure a blue legacy by protecting the ocean. Just as an aside, it kind of worked. We don't talk about Bush for all the bad things he did. We just talk about the ocean. So I'll just throw that out there. And I want to zoom out and look at the rest of the world. And I'm going to start that story the year after Columbus got lost and thought he landed in India. Now, just a trigger warning, I'm going to say some things right now that may be difficult for some of you to hear. Anyone know who this is? David, shut up. I'll give you a hint. He was born in what we call Spain today. He was also the final boss in the video game Assassin's Creed 2. Seriously, like you get to like punch him at the end. I'm not making that up. And Jeremy Irons played him on TV. Yes, Pope who? David. Are you really the only person who, does anybody else know this besides David? Yes, Rodrigo, the TV show was called The Borgias. Yeah, two guys. Or you probably watched the show and you probably played the video game. Yeah. So Rodrigo Borgia, he eventually became Pope Alexander VI. So white dudes deciding what's good for half of the planet is a 500-year-old idea. And Pope Alexander VI is the original half-earth bro. So here's a map of the world as we know it today. In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. But then in 1493, Pope Alexander VI issued the papal bull and gave the New World to Spain. So there's the line, gave half the world to Spain. It's kind of upset the Portuguese. But in the immortal spirit of John Lennon and Paul McCartney, they said, we can work it out. And in 1494, they signed the Treaty of Tordesillas. This gave half the globe, 370 leagues west of Cape Verde, to Spain, and the other half to Portugal. And the way this line is drawn is why they speak Portuguese in Brazil, and why they speak Spanish in Argentina and Chile, and it's why so many people living in those former colonies are Catholic. This was the first instance of a powerful man in Europe carving up the globe by drawing lines on a map. And I don't think I need to tell anyone in Africa or the Middle East how many problems this practice has caused. This treaty disrupted the lives of millions of non-Christian indigenous peoples. I am literally a great example of that. Magellan landed in Guam in 1521, that was 500 years ago. One day, a Spanish sailor named Cristobal Villagomez landed in Guam. 250 years later, one of his descendants named their kid Angelo Villagomez. I'm still Spanish, and I'm still Catholic. But one of the really sinister legacies of genocide and colonialism is how it strips people of their identity. Chamorro, that's the name of my people, but it's not something we called ourselves. It's what the Spanish called us. And the name of our islands are not our own either. It's named after the Spanish queen who colonized us. I talked about my family history at the start of this presentation, and generations of my family have been punished by colonizers, including the United States. The U.S. used to punish Chamorros for speaking our native language, like in the 60s and 70s. So English is my primary language, and I speak with an American accent because the United States won a war. And because previous colonizers, Spain, Germany, and Japan, they lost one. There would be more half-earth bros. In 1612, the British and Dutch signed the Treaty of Dover, giving the Northern Hemisphere to the British, the Southern Hemisphere to the Dutch, and they agreed everyone would be Protestant. Other colonizing countries wouldn't draw such straight lines. The French thought it was their job to civilize the ancient cultures in Asia and Africa. And the U.S. thought it was its manifest destiny to steal all of the native land between New York and Los Angeles. And these lines were never static. The United States claimed any island with guano on it in the mid-19th century, overthrew the Hawaiian government in 1898, and by the end of World War II, controlled every island between the Philippines and the Line Islands of Kiribati. In the second half of the 20th century, many former colonies achieved freedom and became independent nations. But there are still remaining colonies, particularly island nations in the Pacific and Atlantic. Oops. Drawing lines eventually extended to the ocean, and in 1994, the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea was ratified, and every country with a coastline was given economic control of the sea out to 200 miles from shore. You're probably, some of you at least, are probably uncomfortable asking yourself why I'm bringing this up at an ocean conservation meeting. It's because my thesis is that the combination of colonialism and EEZs have been the deciding factor in the success of 30 by 30 to date. Let me say that again. Colonialism and EEZs have been the deciding factor in the success of 30 by 30 to date. If you look at the top 20 marine reserves around the world, together they account for 92.6% of global coverage of protected areas. This is how many are in overseas territories. The biggest burden of achieving 30 by 30 is being carried by these overseas territories. And in many cases, and absolutely in the United States, nearly all of the benefit goes to white institutions and capitals like London, Paris, and Washington, D.C., or to universities and research centers across the country. Now, to be clear, I'm not suggesting that these actions from decades and centuries ago are the sole reason why these areas are protected over others. There is a very powerful fishing industry that fights any and all of these designations. But it is politically easier to force policies onto territories, especially when it is done with the stroke of an executive's pen. At this point, it's worth revisiting that criteria for selecting big MPAs. 20 years of work looking for areas that were big, with limited fishing, and a country with a history of conservation and some hope of enforcement brought us to this point. But if we had looked for overseas territories and we asked for, the indigenous perspective is, if we had just looked for overseas territories of wealthy countries with large, powerful militaries, where mostly indigenous people have limited voting power, we'd be in the exact damn place. Same damn place. Now, Beth Pike led on a paper, MCI is in the house, and they assessed the 100 largest global MPAs against the MPA guide. Her team is actually presenting on this work in this room in the next session, so I'm not going to get too much into the details, but her work gives number to how much of our MPA coverage lies in these distant EEZs, about two-thirds of marine reserves. But her team also found that too many MPAs are poorly designed, meaning they allow damaging activities like drilling and industrial fishing, or they're poorly implemented, meaning that they lack management plans or staff. The take home is that our understanding of how much of the ocean is protected or conserved is vastly overestimated, right? We're hearing 8%, but the areas that are well protected are mostly the burden of indigenous peoples. So my opinion is that 30 by 30 on the ocean has reached a breaking point because we've run out of colonies to protect. Switching gears a little bit, marine biodiversity dialogues funded by LenFest and the National Marine Sanctuary Foundation, they found a different shortcoming, namely that in the U.S., only a fraction of the biodiversity in the ocean is contained within MPAs. This is mostly because they're all concentrated in one region of the country, as I've already shown. This is very frustrating, right? You know, I'm a big supporter of 30 by 30. When I worked at Pew, I actually wrote the resolution that was passed at IUCN. And we're very used to having fishermen disagree with us, but many liberal institutions are ill-equipped to understand and never mind deal with the issues that Black, Indigenous, and other marginalized communities deal with. And there are scientists that, you know, pointing out that despite our best efforts, too many of our outcomes are poorly designed, poorly implemented, and unjust. I did that backwards, sorry. This brings me to Goodhart's Law. Has anybody ever heard of Goodhart's Law? Three, great, good. You're learning something today, hooray. This was first coined by British economist Charles Goodhart, first used to criticize British monetary policy, but since we're in South Africa, and since Arthur did it during his plenary, I asked ChatGPT to explain Goodhart's Law to me using cricket. I watch baseball. I have no idea how cricket works. So imagine Cricket South Africa sets a target to improve the team's batting average to boost overall performance. Initially, this seems like a good measure to enhance the team's competitiveness. However, as players and coaches focus solely on improving batting averages, unintended consequences might arise. For example, batsmen might start playing more conservatively to avoid getting out, leading to fewer risks and potentially lower overall scores. This could make matches less exciting, and less exciting than they already are. Imagine that. And this could reduce the team's chances of winning in situations that require aggressive play. In essence, by turning the batting average into a primary target, CSA might inadvertently undermine the broader goal of improving overall team performance. There's also a really great paper written about 10 years ago that talks about the IUCN Red List and Goodhart's Law. I highly recommend reading it. So one expression of the unintended consequences of Goodhart's Law applied to ocean conservation is there's 9 countries or territories out there claiming that 99% of their ocean is already protected. And they submit this data to WDPA. I pulled this off their website. I've, you know, in the many presentations this week, I heard about whole ocean management. But I mean, like, come on. Like, this is the purpose of 30 by 30 was not to just go claim that your entire ocean is conserved. And I've got some of the numbers. And so it's about 4 million square kilometers for these 9, which is about 13% of all of the protected areas on the planet are in these countries that claim they've protected everything. There's also a lot of MPAs that were designated in places where there was no fishing taking place to begin with. Veronica Rolano, she used Sea Around Us data, and she showed that EEZ designations 40 years ago did more to stop foreign fishing than subsequent MPA designations. So it's like, you know, she uses like, where's Hawaii? So that they created the EEZ, Reagan declared it in 1983, fishing basically stopped, but the protected area was designated 20 years later. In places where there's no domestic fleet to fill that void of fishing, the EEZ turned into a de facto no-take MPA. In other places, Galapagos, New Caledonia, domestic fishing continued. Rolano only looked at 4 EEZs in her paper, but you can look at Global Fishing Watch on the internet, and you can get a sense that this phenomena exists in other places. A lot of the overseas are still unfished. And I'll use the example, so the Marianas, where I'm from, well, where is it? Oh, up here, right? This big blue spot, that's about 1 million square kilometers. It's bigger than the East Coast of the United States. The Mariana Trench Monument is only about 40,000 square kilometers. So there's no fishing here. And there's been no fishing for 40 years. So it's not the MPA, it's the EEZ. So if we're only protecting places that have no fishing, there might actually be evidence that we've already achieved 30 by 30. Some of you know this paper. This is David Kruzma and others, and they used AIS data, and they showed that 55% of the ocean was fished. Fishery scientists didn't like that number, so they used smaller grids, and they said, no, they used the exact same data, and they said, actually, only 4% of the ocean is fished. So there's a real threat that saying you've protected 30% of the ocean is becoming more important than actually protecting the ocean. And this is the place where 30 by 30 fails, when it becomes an exercise in creative accounting. It needs to be one of taking bold action, delivering conservation policy, and doing hard work. And this is sort of like the crux of my presentation. I'm kind of coming to the end here. I do think that we're very much in this 30 by 30 era. And it would be ridiculous for me to claim that all of the global leaders, funders, NGOs, and communities who bought into this movement are wrong. I don't think they're wrong, but I think the usefulness of 30 by 30 is based on outdated values. So I'm not asking that it goes away, but rather I'm hoping that something new will emerge out of it. I think we can still take the best parts of 30 by 30. This is the agreement that sacred places are in the ocean, an understanding that there needs to be on-the-ground action with benefits and costs shared equitably, the promise of international support with funding and expertise, and a commitment to not walk away once a win is achieved, and to support communities for the long term. I'm very concerned about the goals that our movement is going to set for ourselves in the 2030s. I am worried that a half-Earth movement, or a 50 by 50, will lead to more lines on maps made by rich, powerful men, and an amplification of all the worst shortcomings of 30 by 30. I do think a lot of the ideas of what ocean conservation will look like in the 2030s are already inside the heads of all of you people in this room. In the many talks I heard this week, I heard so many great stories and strong ideas for improving what we do. Many of the MPA guide scientists talk about the need to focus on quality over quantity to deliver conservation. And is Asha here? Hey, Asha DeVos. She always reminds us that every coastline needs a hero. I didn't steal it, I said your name. Barbara Horta Acosta, she spoke about how active management provides better outcomes than areas that are simply implemented. Is Anna Spaulding here? It's her birthday. Should we sing happy birthday now or after the talk? Now? After the talk, okay. But she spoke about how different types of metrics, like measuring participation in MPA processes, can be used to define success. She also asked us what a post 30 by 30 era looks like. It was the only other Taylor Swift, was it supposed to be a Taylor Swift mention? It wasn't, she claims it's not, but I know it was. Steve Johnson spoke about how it takes a long time to implement big MPAs. And that doesn't mean we should give up on them. It means that those communities and managers need greater levels of support. And organizations like the Blue Nature Alliance, my former employer, Big Ocean, you know, they're working to make all those big MPAs more equitable. And MCI and the Green List are working to make them better. And I heard multiple strategies for changing the how of conservation. 2024 is 6 years away from the 2030 deadline. At this point in 2014, we were already talking about the next thing. We were dubbing it the post-2020 framework. We also need a post-2030 framework, but it needs to take into account all of the social science we have collected in the last decade. Oops. And we need to combine that social science with indigenous knowledge to come up with the goals that actually inspire real action. I have a buddy, Chris Parsons, he's not here this week, but he likes to say that it takes 10 years to go from science to policy. 30% has been around for 20 years already. It is woefully out of date in this post-George Floyd world and post-Standing Rock world. That's kind of the end of my official remarks. I'll end it with this mural I saw a couple years ago on the Dutch island of Saba. As scientists, we sometimes get caught up in our scientific arguments to protect nature. Fishery scientists like to argue with the MPA scientists. But let's not forget that I love sharks is an equally valid argument for protecting sharks. Like the Beatles said, all you need is love. Thank you, everyone. So just real quick, I'm on stage for like 5 hours today. Thank you, David. If you'd like to continue some of these discussions, I invite you to the Beyond 30 by 30 symposium taking place in this room immediately afterwards, after this. My colleague, Dr. Alia Hidayat, will present on how the Center for American Progress plans to propose a 30 by 30 framework in the United States. And then later today, we're gonna continue this discussion at a workshop hosted by CAP and Lenfest. And if you work in the United States on nearshore habitats, oops, I hit the wrong button again. If you work in the United States on nearshore habitats, we'd love for you to take our survey. Thank you, everybody.
I wasn't expecting.